Special shout out to NordVPN for making this video possible. More on that in just a little bit. So as you probably guessed, today we're going to do a deep dive into electric vehicles to see if they are actually better or worse for the environment. We've covered other aspects of driving dynamics, performance, and cost of ownership in other videos, so be sure to subscribe and check them out. However, today, we have to address a comment we get all the time, that Teslas are actually worse for the environment. Running this channel, we're always amazed by the divide between people who love EVs and those who hate them. There are a few key points that people often cite when arguing that electric vehicles aren't as clean as you think. The first is that manufacturing electric vehicles has a larger carbon footprint than gasoline cars, due to the additional need for batteries. The second reason is that mining and extracting all the different elements like nickel and cobalt is also dangerous for the environment. The third common point of contention is that while EVs don't pollute as they drive, the grid from which they draw their electricity most surely does. It's often stated that an electric car is just a coal-powered car. There is merit to some of these points, so that's why today we're going to set the record straight. To answer this question, we have to look at the carbon footprint of manufacturing electric cars and gasoline cars, and then the carbon footprint throughout their respective life cycles. Many also believe that driving your old car is better for the environment than it is to manufacture a new one. So for good measure, let's also throw in an old, used car. According to BTS.gov, the average vehicle in the United States is about 11 years old. For the electric vehicle in this comparison, we're going with the best-selling EV of 2018, the Tesla Model 3. For a gasoline car, we're going to look at the best-selling, comparable, brand-new 2018 Toyota Camry. For our used car, we'll look at an 11-year-old 2007 Toyota Camry. Both Camrys are V6s to better compete with the performance of the Model 3. Thanks to Volkswagen and Dieselgate, diesel cars are quickly becoming persona non grata. So we'll look at the 2014 Volkswagen Passat TDI. Lastly, for our hybrid, let's go with the venerable, ubiquitous 2018 Toyota Prius. Let's start with the carbon footprint of manufacturing a new car. Admittedly, this one is tricky, if not outright impossible. To fully understand the complete carbon footprint of building a new car, we'd have to consider every drop of gasoline burned to transport components, factory power consumption and emissions, and the cascading emissions of each sub-vendor. So it suffices to say that we're going to have to take some liberties and make some assumptions. But let's be clear about this. Of all the ways we've seen to approximate this value, we think it makes the most sense to assess it by vehicle weight. The larger and heavier vehicle, the larger its carbon footprint. We have three data points upon which we'll base our assumptions. The Citroën C1, a tiny, compact car, produces 6 tons or 6,000 kilograms of CO2 equivalent to manufacture and weighs about 800 kilograms. Now, what is CO2 equivalent, you might be asking? Well, usually we hear about carbon dioxide when talking about greenhouse gases, but there are several others like methane and hydrofluorocarbons. The climate change potential of other gases is weighed against carbon dioxide and based on quantities of each combined to form a carbon dioxide equivalent score. For example, methane is 25 times more impactful on climate change, and so 1 kilogram of methane would have a carbon dioxide equivalent rating of 25 kilograms. Okay, so our next data point is a Ford Mondeo, a mid-sized sedan that emits 17 tons of CO2e to manufacture and weighs about 1,600 kilograms. Lastly, a Land Rover Discovery emits 35 tons of CO2e to manufacture and weighs about 2,200 kilograms. If we fit these data points on a curve and use a best fit line, we have ourselves a crude model to approximate all the cars in our comparison. Now we know this isn't exact, but EVs like Teslas tend to weigh a lot, and with our model, the results are close to what we'd expect. So we aren't going to apply an additional battery emission tax. We'll allow the gross vehicle weight to account for it. We found it interesting that the emission levels don't increase linearly with curb weight, but closer to a power of 2. We only have 3 data points, so we're not going to read too much into this, but it does make sense. As you add weight, you have more components, more electronics, doors, windows, seats, cloth, and a beefed up chassis to support it all. Now with all that math, we have a baseline for our day one emissions levels. The new Camry starts at 15.5 tons of CO2e, the Prius 12.5, the Passat at 16.5, and the Tesla Model 3 at 22. So because of the Tesla Model 3's high curb weight of 4,000 pounds or 1,800 kilograms, it has polluted the most upon taking delivery. Now the old 2007 Camry has the same emissions levels as the new Camry, but being used, we started at 0. Based on the EPA website, we have data for emissions in grams per mile for each car. Factoring 15,000 miles a year and converting to metric tons, which is 1,000 kilograms, we have the following values in tons of CO2e annually for each vehicle. Now, many of our commenters have pointed out that people tend to only consider the emissions from burning a gallon of gasoline, as if gasoline just grows on trees. In reality, there's an entire upstream emissions value for gasoline, and the EPA website provides that too. So all of our figures include emissions from the tailpipe, plus all the upstream emissions to extract, refine, and ship gasoline. For the Tesla and all EVs, this is a function of where you live and how clean your energy grid happens to be. So we will look at Tesla ownership in the most prominent US market, California, and also in West Virginia, a state where coal makes up more than 90% of its energy production. Your numbers will fall somewhere in between, and if you live in an especially clean country, like many in Europe, your figures will be even better than California. Before we get into results, let's talk about our sponsor, NordVPN. In an age of connectivity where cars talk to each other and drive themselves, the importance of your online security and privacy are paramount. If you travel, you're probably going to be joining public Wi-Fi networks, either at airports or hotel rooms, and with NordVPN, you can encrypt all your web traffic with military-grade AES 256-bit encryption. Even if you're home and you don't want your internet service provider to see everything you're doing, NordVPN keeps all your data private. You can even be behind the Great Firewall of China. Choose a VPN node in your home country and watch all your Netflix shows just like you were at home. If you use the link in the video description, you'll get an extra month free and pay less than $3 per month to completely protect up to 6 devices. Check out nordvpn.org/2bitdavinci. Okay, so on day one, the used Camry jumps out to an early lead with a zero emissions value. Yeah, it's true, buying a used car really is good for the environment. But let's see how long that lead lasts. Fast forwarding to year 5, we already see some exciting lead changes. Now the cleanest car is the Prius, followed closely in second by the Tesla in California. Coming in third is the used Camry, followed by the Tesla in West Virginia. Then the diesel Passat, and in dead last is the brand new Toyota Camry. In just a little over 3 years, a brand new Prius pollutes less than the used Camry. The Tesla in either state is cleaner than both the new diesel Passat and the brand new Camry in less than 3 years. The Tesla in California becomes the cleanest car by about 5.5 years. Lastly, the diesel Passat beats the used Camry, becoming the fourth cleanest car by year 11.5. These results are pretty surprising to us because we thought the used Camry would do much better than it ended up doing. The Tesla, shockingly, even with its big battery pack, beats its closest rivals in less than 3 years. Just for fun, we ran the same numbers on the best-selling vehicle in the United States over the last 3 decades, the Ford F-150 pickup truck. With curb weights between 4,000 and 5,000 pounds, we started its life at the same 22 tons of CO2e as the Tesla. With its lowest in comparison fuel efficiency figures, it has the most significant carbon footprint. Lastly, there's one more critical point about Tesla owners. According to a report by Clean Technica, between 28 and 40% of EV drivers also have solar panels. You've probably heard of people saying their cars run on sunshine, and for many, it's true. According to a study by Solar Innova, the lifetime emissions per kilowatt hour produced for a photovoltaic solar panel is 72 grams. So we're also going to add a third Tesla, but this one is powered purely by solar panels. Again, the emissions aren't zero because there's an environmental price to pay for manufacturing, transporting, and installing solar panels. However, it's incredibly low, and unlike the Tesla powered by the California grid that takes 5.5 years to beat the Prius, the solar-powered Tesla wins in just 3.5 years. We discussed some of these ideas in our hydrogen fuel cell versus battery electric video. And one key point from that video is that all the figures we've shown here are a snapshot of the present. But in the 15 years we've extrapolated, electricity and gasoline are heading in very different directions. Just 10 years ago in California, only about 10% of its energy came from renewable sources. Whereas today, that number is about 30%. This trend will continue as solar and wind gets cheaper and cheaper, while finding new oil sources gets harder and harder. In the case of oil, we need to revisit the concept of EROI, or Energy Return on Investment. It's like a financial investment. If you invest $1,000 and end up making $2,000, your ROI is 2. Similarly, EROI is the measure of energy created divided by the energy required to create it. Let's look at oil imports from 1990, which had an EROI of 35. In 2005, it dropped to 18. In 2007, down to just 12. Oil is getting harder and harder to produce and requires more energy. All the easy-to-reach oil is pretty much gone, and what's left is in oil sands and oil shale, which needs to be heated to separate before it can even be shipped to refine. Offshore drilling is also very labor-intensive, and pumping and transportation costs will also continue to rise. So in the next 15 years, the emissions from 1 gallon of gasoline will continue to rise, and there's a good chance that energy grids will actually get cleaner in the same period. So if anything, EVs are going to be even cleaner than we think. In case you disagree with our approach to calculating manufacturing emissions, we're going to share our spreadsheets and calculators so you can adjust it as you wish. However, the reality is that electric vehicles really are cleaner and better for the environment. Gasoline can never get cleaner, and it will only get dirtier with time. So the sooner electric cars prevail, the sooner we can start cleaning up our act. If you think that the incredible stress of all these future EVs would have on the power grid would be a problem, don't worry, we have a future video plan to cover this. Lastly, there's a problem of recycling these big EV battery packs. According to Tesla, they have a partnership providing a closed-loop battery recycling program. This paper is from 2011, and much has changed. As EV sales move from hundreds of thousands to millions, it will become increasingly lucrative for companies to start up and recycle old battery packs. Tesla claims that this recycling process can reduce 70% of the emissions of mining and refining the raw materials from the source. So while studies suggest that end-of-life recycling can contribute another 1 to 4 tons of CO2e, we aren't going to add that to our final numbers because those same values will reduce future EV manufacturing emissions by a similar amount. We are going to dive into the recycling aspect of EV batteries in a future video. So what do you guys think? Were the results surprising? There's a lot of misinformation out there, so please consider sharing this video on Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. Special thanks to all of our patrons on Patreon. And if you're new, we hope you'll consider supporting us and become a patron. We have many videos around the future of energy and transportation, so we hope you'll subscribe and check out our other videos. We're Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you for watching.